Well, good morning. We want to welcome you to the service. We're excited for you to be here this morning. And we are excited about what God's going to do in the service this morning. If you're a father here today, would you please stand? Would you please stand? I want every one of you to give them a hand. Happy Father's Day to you. We are proud, and I want you to know this morning, if you're a father here today, if you're a man that is here today, this sermon is for you today, okay? If you're a woman here today, you can amen and punch him and say, hey, you need to hear this, whatever you feel you need to do, or you can pray for them that they get this by the end of the service, okay? But it's going to be a good day today. We do have a couple announcements that we want to make. Tonight we will have support group at 6 o'clock. If you have not been to support group, I encourage you to come. Listen, if you have any struggle in your life, we've said this before, this is not just for people who have drug problems or anything like that. If you have any struggle in your life that is controlling you, if it's worry, if it's fear, if it's anything like that, I promise you this group will help you with that. And I encourage you to be here tonight for that at 6 o'clock.
And if you don't have a struggle, you can come and help all of us.
That's exactly right. If you don't have a struggle, you're lying. So, okay. And then you do have a struggle because you just lied and said you don't have a struggle. All right. Then also on Wednesday night at 6:30, we're going to have our senior recognition. And this will be this coming up Wednesday night at 6:30. We will have finger foods, but we will have people who serve finger foods to you. So please make your plans to be here on Wednesday night at 6:30 for our senior recognition. We have three awesome seniors who are graduating, and we want you to be here to support them on Wednesday night. Are there any other announcements that we need to make? Man, y'all don't be this quiet.
We just gotta figure out a time to do prayer.
Yes, we will pray Wednesday night as well. Let's just do this. Let's just pray after it's over. Will that work? As soon as everything's over, we'll pray. Because we've been having prayer group on Wednesday night. We'll just stay and pray whenever the service is over Wednesday night. All right, we do want to start off with a time of praise. A lot of you don't know this, but we have been praying for Brady and Adriana for a long time. She has went through some struggles, and they've been trying to have a baby, and they found out this week they're going to have one. And that is an answered prayer. And we want to make that announcement, and here's what I want to say to you. That is an answered prayer that God has given them, but continue to pray, okay? They're very early, and we just ask you to pray with them through this. I asked them if it was okay for us to share that God had answered that prayer. When I say it's been a struggle for them, and God has answered this prayer, and I just wanted you to know that God had heard your prayers for them. So we give God praise for that. We also want to tell you, Wallace wanted you to know there's upper rooms in the back as you leave. You can't go out that door, but you can get an upper room and go out that door. So, hey, will you move those to that door? And that way it'll be easier on them. All right? So you can get one of those when you leave. Any other praises at this time you guys have? Man, God's been good to y'all, huh? Amen. Amen. Cheryl, you're a very good man to put up with Gina that long, okay? And I will say amen to that, too. Awesome. Awesome. Well, y'all be careful, and we pray for safe travels.
And on the same day that they were married, we celebrated. I've been putting up there 46 years.
Amen. Any other prayer requests or praises? We do want to continue to pray for Gary, Poole, and their families. Please continue to pray for them daily.
Miss Jo Sparks.
Miss Jo Sparks.
Pray for Terry.
Okay, Taryn.
Kristen.
I can't hear the last name.
Shouse.
Shouse, okay. Sorry, it's hard to hear up here. Gage. Amen. Praise God. Anybody else? Renee, we continue to pray for Renee. Okay. Well, all right. Y'all ready to worship today?
Amen.
Amen. Listen, I pray that every Sunday when you walk in those doors, I hope you know you've been prayed for. Wednesday night, we prayed for you specifically that when we got in here this morning, the Holy Spirit would fall on this place. And I believe God's going to hear those prayers today. So I pray as we worship today, you're excited about what God has in store for us. So let's pray and we'll begin to worship. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for this awesome day that we have just to be in your house. And God, for the fathers that are here today, Lord, I just say thank you for them. Lord, I know there are many men that are here today that have led their family to you. And God, that many of their family are here today because of their leadership, and we thank you for that. And God, I also know there's many fathers who have gone on before us. Lord, I know my father has, but God, I am so thankful for the example that he set in my life that, Lord, that I will never forget. Lord, that made an impact on me, that is still being passed on today, and I thank you for that. And God, as we are here in this service today, God, we lift up you. And I just pray that in the name of Jesus, as Lord, as we worship today, you will put our minds aside from anything else, and God, we would just focus on you. Because God, we need you in here today. And God, I pray as we are here today, God, this will not just be a service where we go through the motions, but this will be a service where we truly, truly, truly encounter you. God, I thank you in closing that, God, you are hearing our prayers. God, I thank you for the wonderful miracle that we shared this morning about the baby. God, I just thank you for that. Lord, there's many prayers that have gone into that, and we just praise you for it. And God, I thank you that, Lord, just every day, I'm having somebody say, hey, I had this prayer answered. That just last week, there were several that their backs were hurting and then they were prayed for and they've had good weeks. And I thank you, God, because only you can do that. And we give you the glory for that. Lord, once again, we pray that your Holy Spirit will be here today. And God, I just pray that you will have your will and way. And we will give you the glory and the honor for everything you do. In your name I pray. Amen.
All right, y'all stand and join me in worship this morning.
Take me under, baptize, I need you.
Oh, I need you, your forgiveness is like sweet, sweet honey on my lips, like the sound of a symphony to my ears, like holy water. Notice that we're down a man or a woman this morning. But it's all right. We're still going to make it. We're still going to be all right. Go ahead and skip to that next song. Yeah, there you go.
Unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song. A deliverance from my enemies until all my fears are gone. And I'm no longer fear. Oh, I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. No, I am a child of God. From my mother's womb, you have chosen me. Has called my name, and I've been born again to your family. Your blood flows through my veins, and I'm no longer a slave to fear. Oh, I am a child of God, and I'm no longer a slave in a fear. Oh, I am a child of God. You split so I can walk right through it, and my fears are drowned in perfect love. You rescued me so I would stand as I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave in the field. Oh, I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave in the field. Oh, I am a child of God.
Be seated for a second.
I have to share something with you this morning. That's my anthem song. Most of you may know, or all of my life I've dealt with anxiety and depression. The devil knows if he gets in your mind, he's got a direct line to your heart. And for years, I've struggled with it, with anxiety, depression, the fear. Was I good enough? Did I say the right thing? Did I do the right thing? It had really come to a head this past few months. Weeks. Tuesday, I ended up in the doctor's office trying to decide whether or not I needed to check myself in somewhere and get help. Because I felt like the devil had a hold right here. He'd taken my joy away. He'd taken my everything that I was away. After talking to Missy and my sister-in-law, and we decided we would just give it a few days and let God work. Jennifer had prayed for me. Others had prayed for me. This past Wednesday night, I came to men's Bible study. And after the Bible study, Karen prayed over me. And guys, I have to step back. In 1987, I was 6 years old, and the church went to Eureka Springs. We watched the Passion play. And I love watching the Passion play, but I went, and if you've been to Eureka Springs and watched the Passion play, you know there's a area that you can go and watch the potter working at his wheel. And he talks about the story in the Bible about the potter working his wheel, and the lump of clay was marred. But he kept working with it, and he made it into a new vessel. That's what he's done with me this week. But when I was there at the Passion play, when I was 6 years old, I bought a vase. The vase has been missing. For years, I've tore my house apart looking for it. I've tore Mom's house apart looking for it. That was my, if most of you know that Missy and I do pottery stuff, that was my inspiration, that God could take this marred lump of clay and make it into something new. Wednesday night, after we finished praying, I went home. And there it said in the cabinet. It had a verse on the bottom of it. Now, it was a God thing that the vase was there, but it's even more a God thing, the verse that was on the bottom of it. How many of you have heard of Isaiah 61:3? It says, to provide for Zion's mourners, to give them a crown in place of ashes, an oil of joy in place of mourning, a mantle of praise in place of discouragement. They will be called oaks of righteousness, planted by the Lord to glorify himself. It wasn't by coincidence that that vase and that verse was on that vase. God set me free from that fear. And I give him all the honor and glory for it. But, you know, I was searching a little bit more. Was looking at the number 33. If you look at the significance of the number 33, it talks about courage and inspiration. And that vase, 33 years old this year. God is good. Thank you.
When we were sound checking this morning, Brother Nathan started playing this song, and he had been on me to learn it. So I said, "All right, well, I'll learn it right now." So I sat up here on the stage and started kind of picking through it. And that's, I don't know, this is kind of something I've always done, is I've always loved hearing songs and trying to pick them out and stuff. And this is an old song by. You still got me on that Jeremy Camp roll. This is an old Jeremy Camp song, man. I'm telling you. Y'all, Mr. Danny's had me on Jeremy Camp for a month. But this song, it talks about the faithfulness of God, and I think this goes along really well with your testimony this morning. But there's a song when I was doing a lot of digging into scriptures regarding the faithfulness of God, and I was kind of digging into it, and there's a psalm, it's Psalm 89, which actually wasn't written by David, which is like most of them were. You know, this one was written by a man named Ethan the Ezrite. And I did a little bit of digging into who this guy was. And he was an instrumentalist in the court of David. Some people say he probably played the cymbals. So for those of you drummers out there, you know, there's a little hope for you. Maybe you can get a song out there. And the name Ethan, I came across like the Hebrew meaning of the name Ethan, and it literally means strong and enduring. And I thought, wow, okay, here's a guy writing about the faithfulness of God when really the best description is within his own name, you know. But the first, I'll just read to you the first two verses right here. It says, "I will sing of the Lord's great love forever. With my mouth, I will make your faithfulness known through all the generations. I will declare that your love stands firm forever and that you established your faithfulness in heaven itself." So whatever you're bringing with you in here, God is faithful through it all. And that's kind of what this song's about. Scattered words, empty thoughts seem to pour from my heart. I've never felt so torn before. Seems I don't know where to start. But it's now that I feel grace falls like rain from every fingertip, washing away my pain. And I still believe in your faithfulness. And I still believe in your truth. And I still believe your holy word. Though the questions fog up my mind, with the promises I still seem to bear, when the answers slowly unwind, it's my heart I see you prepare. But it's now that I feel your grace falls like rain from every fingertip, washing away my pain. I still believe in your faithfulness. And I still believe in your truth. And I still believe your holy word, even when I can't see, I still believe. All right, y'all pray with me. Lord, we thank you this morning, God, for your faithfulness, for your love. And God, we just ask that you come to us now, Lord, and speak to us through your word. Speak to us through Brother Nathan, God. Just prepare our hearts to hear from you, Lord. We ask all this in your son's name. Amen.
Awesome job to learn that song this morning, right? That is awesome. Awesome. I watched the movie that just came out, and if you haven't seen it, you need to watch it. It's I Still Believe, and it's such an awesome movie because it talks about answered prayers. And as I look across, and I was thinking as Billy was singing that song, how many answered prayers are here this morning? I mean, how many times have people prayed for you and God answered that prayer? And man, what an awesome song to celebrate that. That we are here and we still believe that he can answer prayers. Amen. We don't serve a God who was. We serve a God who is and will ever be. Amen. And we got to remember that. We got to remember that in our prayers. In Daniel chapter 6, and I said this earlier, I want you to know this morning, if you are a man here today, okay, this message is for you. If you are a woman here today and you're not married, you need to pray today that when you get married, your man will be this man, okay? If you are married today, if you want to elbow your husband, you can and say, get this. Or if you want to pray for him through it, you can do that as well, okay? But I want to encourage you with this. I want to entitle this message, Man Up. I went to a Bible study on Tuesday mornings with Tommy Wilson and some other men, and we were there one day, and they had had a men retreat, and a guy gave me a book, and as he gave it to me, I had no idea. I remember getting the book, but I don't even remember reading the book and started reading the book until this week. He gave me a book, and it was entitled Man Up. Did you get one of those? He gave us one, and it was from a conference they had went to, and I began to read it. In the first chapter in it, it says this: in the church today, we have too many wimpy men. And I want to say this, when I read that, it hit me right in the face. And men, you're not going to like what I'm going to say to you when I say this, but in the church today, men are not leading in the way that we're supposed to lead. I want you to understand it is important for you to understand your role in your household, your role in the church. God intended for you to step up and help lead. And it is important for you to understand that unfortunately in the church, a lot of times at prayer meetings, it is the women who are showing up and not the men. A lot of times when we are trying to plan and do leadership stuff, it is the women that are having to lead and not the men. And I want you to understand it is important for you in your home and in the church to lead the way that God has called you to lead. That is the reason on Wednesday night it is important for you not to just tell your kids, go to church, man, support them in doing that. That is the reason why on Sunday morning, when you get up, man, you be the first one telling your family, this is where we're gonna go. It is important for you to man up. And here's the thing I wanna say to you. I have no doubt if a man came in here with a knife and began to try to attack your family right now, every one of you would fight until you died in order to keep your family alive. Because you're a man, you want to fight for them. But the problem is, spiritually in the home today, the devil is trying to destroy homes and trying to destroy your kids and trying to destroy your marriage. And a lot of times, spiritually, we never fight back. You need to hear that. And I know this is hard, but it's truth. Listen, the devil wants no more than to get the soul of your children and your grandchildren and make them spend an eternity in a hell, and that should scare you to death. But here's the thing I want you to know that God wants you to do today. He wants you to man up and be the man you're supposed to be so that you can lead them to Jesus and show them what it is to walk with Him. Now, I want to share with you some stats. Listen to me. These are some stats of fathers who are not in homes. Listen to these, okay? And I promise you we're gonna get to the scripture and read it when we start getting to this, but I wanna read this first. Children are four times at a greater risk of poverty when the father is not leading in the way they're supposed to in the home. Four times greater risk of poverty. Seven times more likely to become pregnant as a teen if the father is not leading in the home. Five times more likely to abuse drugs and alcohol if the father's not leading correctly in the home. Two times more likely to drop out of high school. Three times more likely to end up in prison. Can I tell you something today, men? Listen to me. It matters if you lead or not inside your home. Can I get an amen? It matters. I promise you this. Tommy Wilson will tell you this. In the support group that he leads with Living Free, 95% of the people that come through his doors on Thursday nights have a problem where the father did not lead in the home in the way they were supposed to. And what happened is because the father didn't lead and the relationship was broken with the child, they ended up reaching out and doing things that they shouldn't have reached out to do. And it is important for you as a man, your number one job is to lead your family to Christ. And in order to do that, you've got to be right with Christ. Now, I want to share with you in this scripture, the book of Daniel is one of my favorite books in the whole Bible. And in Daniel chapter 6, it is an important chapter. Daniel is sitting there, and God has done some tremendous things in his life. In the life of him and Shadrach and Meshach and Abednego. And here in Daniel chapter 6, what happens is they are sitting there and the king has appointed some new leaders. And as he has appointed these new leaders, they don't like Daniel because they know Daniel believes and leads different than what they do. So what he does is they begin to say, how can we trip Daniel up? And here's what happens. And I want to give you four things as a man today from this scripture you need to do in your life. Number one, Daniel led by example. Now listen to this in verse 4. Then the other administrators and high officers began searching for some fault in the way that Daniel was handling government affairs. But they couldn't find anything to criticize or condemn because he was faithful, always responsible, and completely trustworthy. Man, wouldn't you love that be said about you? Did you read the last part? Let me say it again. Here's what it says about Daniel. He was faithful, he was always responsible, and he was completely trustworthy. Now, let me say this to you. Here's what's happening. They are trying to trip Daniel up, and they begin to start looking at him. How can we get him? What can we do to get him out of leadership? And as they start doing this, they would do what we're doing today. Say, if we're doing a background check, what can we find in his background to get him on? And you know what? As they begin to look, they look at Daniel, they see his life, and he is such a man of integrity. He is led by such an example. I want you to know there was nothing that they could find that he had done wrong. Daniel was a man of integrity, and he not only said, live this way, he did it by an example. Bobby Bowden is one of my favorite football coaches. I love Bobby Bowden. And when he coached at Florida State, and he coached at West Virginia, one thing he did at every school he coached is Bobby Bowden would have his meeting with his team. He would start off, and he would begin to talk to them and say, hey, here's what I expect of you. And as he would begin to say all of these things, I expect this, I expect this. The last thing Bobby Bowden would do when he would look to them, he would say this. He would say, I want you to live as I live. He would say, I want you to live a life as I live. Do you realize how strong of a statement that is Bobby Bowden is saying? He is saying, hey, I'm going to be like Daniel. The way I talk is going to be a way you can talk. The way I act is going to be a way that you should act. The way I live is going to be a way you can live. The way I attend church is going to be one you should. The way I'm in the Word, you should be in the Word. The way I'm praying is the way you should pray. And I want you to understand, men, in the home, you don't need to live by telling your kids how to live. You don't need to live by telling your wife what to do. You need to be an example and say, come follow, because I'm going to follow Jesus. And when you do that, I promise you're being what God has told you to be. But here's the problem in the home. Here's what happens. Listen to me. We love to tell our kids, hey, don't cuss. But what do they come hearing from our mouths? We love to tell our kids, hey, don't gossip. But what do they hear coming from us? We love to tell our kids, hey, don't smoke, don't drink. But what do they see coming from us? Here's what I'm telling you. Do not be a person who is sitting there saying, don't do this, don't do that. Be a person that is living a life that your kids can see Jesus and they can say, I want to live like that. Listen, when I look at my dad's life, if I can be like my daddy, I said this week, my dad died over 30 years ago. If I can live like he did, I know I've had a successful life in my Christian life. Why? Because my daddy showed me what it was to live for Jesus. Men, here's what I want to ask you today with your kids. What are you pointing them to in your life? Are you living by example? Are you selling yourself out for Jesus and saying, hey, follow me, I'm going to show you how to get to Jesus? Or are you just telling them that? See, what they need is they need a man in their life who is going to be prayed up, living right, and leading by example for them to follow. Daniel did that. He led by example. The second thing that I want you to see in the life of Daniel, not only did he lead by example, but he was humble. He was humble. Daniel 6:10 says this, now when Daniel learned that the decree had been published, he went home to the upstairs room where the windows open toward Jerusalem three times a day. He got down on his knees and he prayed, giving thanks to his God just as he had done before. Now, here's what happens. They can't find anything to trip him up. So what they say is the only way we can get him, if we tell him he can't do something for God. So they say this, hey, we're going to say that you can't pray to God. And as they say this, Daniel goes upstairs where he always prays, and he continues to pray to God. Why? Because he was humble. You know what Daniel realized in his life? Hey, I can't lead by example without God. You know what we need to realize in our life? We can't do anything apart from God. If we would ever get that in our heart, in our lives, the church in our lives would be a whole lot different place. Daniel realized he needed that time with God where he was praying to God in order for him to be the man he needed to be. Listen, I'm going to say this. We've been doing prayer time on Wednesday night. The most we have had is 15 people. Listen, I'm not all about numbers. I'm all about people seeking Jesus. But don't y'all think, man, it's important for us on Wednesday night to come together and pray together? Thank you, brother. Let's try that again. Is it important for us to come together and pray together? Amen. Listen, while we're doing this, we did it one Wednesday night. We had some families that just needed prayer. And Karen said this after the prayer meeting. You know what she said? She said, Nathan, we need to continue to do this. Did you not? So we need to do it every Wednesday night. We don't need to stop. So this Wednesday night, we showed up, we prayed again. Guess what? Wednesday night, we're going to pray again. Next Wednesday night, we're going to pray again. And you know what we're praying for? We are praying for God to do something that we can't do of ourselves. We are praying for revival. We're praying for salvation. We are praying for God to work and move in situations that we can't describe. Daniel knew this. He was humble. Now, wife, you're going to love this part of the sermon, okay? I want you to know something. Look at your husband if he's here and say you're crazy. Look at him and say this, okay? You can say this. I'm serious. This has a point. You can tell him you're crazy. Men are crazy. Let me tell you why. Men are very prideful, okay? We're very prideful. Listen, let me give you an example of this. A man can come home and have his keys set somewhere where he left them. And all of a sudden, when he gets ready to leave and he begins to look for them, if he can't find them immediately, he's going to go to his kids and say, "What did y'all do with my keys?" Immediately, he's going to go to his wife and he's going to say, "Hey, where are my keys? Where is that?" And immediately, they're going to begin to look for them. Are they here? Are they there? And the man's going to constantly be saying the whole time, "You moved this. You moved this. You did this." And then guess what's going to happen? The man is going to go where he set the keys, and he's going to find them. And usually, you know what's going to happen? This is why men are crazy. We're going to walk out the door and be saying the same thing. "Kids, y'all moved them there. Am I wrong? Honey, you moved them there. Why?" We are prideful. Men are prideful. We do not like to admit when we're wrong. But let me tell you what Daniel was. Daniel was humble. And when he was wrong or when something was going on, he knew he needed God. And what we need in the house today, men, are not men that are prideful that say we never make mistakes. We need to own up when we're not what we need to be. Amen? We don't need men who are prideful. We need men who are like Daniel, who are humble. I read that in a Johnny Hunt book this week, that same story I just gave to you. When I read that, I'm telling you, I showed my wife and she said, "Oh my gosh, that's so you." That's what she said. That's the reason I'm saying so many times we're so prideful and we don't need to be that. We need Daniels who are humble, who are saying, "Hey, listen, I'm not always right. Hey, God, I need you. God, I need your help." There's a couple of scripture I want to read to you about being prideful, and I want to share this before we move on. In Proverbs 13:10, it says this, "Where there is strife, there is pride. But wisdom is found in those who take advice." That is important for us, man. Listen, you don't know everything. You can't run your house by yourself. You can't do things by yourself. You need God. And in order to get that, you got to be humble. The last thing I want you to see with Daniel was prayer was a priority. Listen to this in Daniel 6:10. "Now when Daniel learned that the decree had been published, he went home to his upstairs room, where the wind is open toward Jerusalem. 3 times a day, he got down on his knees and he prayed, giving thanks to his God, just as he had done before." Now, here's the thing with Daniel. Listen to this. Daniel is sitting there. If he prays, he is going into a lion's den. He is going to be put to death. But did you see what that scripture said? Three times a day, he got down on his knees and he prayed. You know why? Prayer was a priority to him, for him. Man, I want to ask you this. You're not facing the lions then. You're not facing persecution. But how often do you pray? Is it a priority for you? Is it something that you want to do? Is it something you feel you need to do? Let me just say this to you, and it's important for you to know this. Without prayer, nothing will ever work in your household. Do you understand that? Without prayer, nothing will ever work. Listen, yesterday, Alex's team was playing baseball, and I coached them. Aiden's the head coach now. I bowed out. Aiden's better than me. But we were coaching them yesterday. We got to the finals, and man, we just couldn't throw a strike. We got our brains beat in the finals. But when the game was over, we circled around, and I looked at every one of those boys, and I said, listen, I looked at the other team, and I looked at our boys. I said, listen, here's what I want to tell you. The most important thing that I want you to know is if you win, give God glory. If you lose, give God glory. And we want you to know tonight, the most important thing you can do is live for Jesus. And you know what we did at the end of the game? We got both teams together. We prayed with each other. You know why? Listen to me. I want my son to know, hey, it's more important to pray than win a baseball game. I want my son to know, hey, it's more important to seek God than it is anything else. And here's what I want to ask you as a father. If your kids follow your example in prayer, what are they getting? If your grandkids follow your example in prayer, what are you getting? What are they going to get? If 10 years from now your kid is leading this church and they're following your example in how you pray, what's this church going to look like? You say, here's what I want you to understand. You've got little eyes watching you every single day. And they're watching you, Daddy, how you talk. They're watching you, Daddy, how you act. They're watching you, Daddy, how you attend church. They're watching you, Daddy, how you read the Word. They are watching you to see how you lead. A couple weeks ago, Polly Johnson came to our support group. And she did something to start off, man, and I'm telling you, stay with me. I couldn't let it go when she left. She had an iPad, and as she got up to speak, she had a timer on it. And we tried to get one up here. We're not smart enough to do it, sorry. But she had a timer on it. And it just was clicking away, second by second. And as she started talking, she looked at us and she said this. She said, this is your life. And seconds are ticking away. And she said, this is your kids' life that you have to influence them. She said, for about 7 or 8 years, I wasted that time that I gave and invested in my kids. She said, I chose to live my way instead of God's way. And she said, for the average teenager, you have about 18 years to make an impact on their life. And if you blow it in those 18 years, it's hard to get back. Now, here's the thing I want to say to you. Those seconds are ticking away. Well, your kids, what are you doing with that time? You know, I have two kids. And, dude, I am going to squall like a baby when it's my kid's senior night. But I got two kids that are 14. I got 4 years. And they're going to be going to college. 4 years. And what I'm telling you, make the most of that time. And the most of that time is not just going and do fun stuff with them. It's investing in the kingdom of God in their life so that they will do the same thing in your grandkids' lives. Because if you don't do it, guess what? They're not going to. And that is why it is so important for you as a man to man up. Some of you are women here today and you're mothers. And you say, I have no man in the home. Guess what? You need a woman up. You got to lead. If your husband is not there to lead, you lead. But I want you to know it is important for us to be that godly example as Daniel was. Listen, in your life, I promise you were influenced by what your parents did for you, whether good or bad. I promise you, you were. And some of you are here today, I know. Lance, what is the difference in your parents made in your life? It's been amazing, right? It's made an impact. You know why? Because they've loved him. They prayed for him. He ain't perfect. Believe it or not, Gina, he's not. He's not perfect. But I'm going to tell you this. When your prayers are praying for a young person like that, I'm telling you, God will take hold of that and will use it. Listen, church, it is time for us as men. It's time for you as women to step up and lead your children in the right direction. We got enough craziness in this world that are leading them in the wrong direction. You have got to pray for them every day. I'm closing with this. David Ball, a lot of you know, he's one of my best friends, a pastor in Tupelo. And he shared this when he was in college. He was not living right, was doing things he shouldn't. His daddy was a Baptist preacher. And his mama came home one night and she knew David was not living right. And she thought David was asleep. She took David by his foot and she just began to pray. And she said this prayer, "Satan, you can't have my baby boy." And she just prayed that over him. And David said as she was saying that prayer, man, he just wept up with tears from that prayer that his mama was saying. Let me just say this. Satan didn't get her baby boy. He's a preacher now. But it came from her saying, "I'm going to pray for him until he changes." Listen, some of your kids may not be living right. Don't give up. Pray. Lead. That is the way God can change their heart. But what we need is some men and some women to be Daniels, to lead by example, to put a priority on prayer, and to live it out in front of them and be humble and say that we can only do this from God. Bow your head and close your eyes with me. Men, here's your challenge today. Women, here's your challenge today. In this invitation, after I pray, Billy's going to sing. I'm going to ask you to take lead in your family today. It may be that you take them, you circle at your seat. It may be you take them, you bring them to the altar. I want you to take the responsibility to say, "I'm going to begin to pray for you today." And if you failed, you haven't been the man you need to be, apologize. Say, "I'm sorry." Man up and say, "I'm going to do better." And start today being what God's called you to be. Father, I come to you and I ask for forgiveness. Because there's way too many times, God, I've got busy. I've ran and done so many things for my kids. But so many times, God, I have not been what I should have been for them in my home. And God, I want to ask for forgiveness. God, I want to say I'm sorry. And God, I ask you to help me, to help other men here today, to stop running so wide open, to stop being so busy that we fail at home from being the father, from being the husband that we need to be. God, I'm going to tell you this. We can't do this by ourselves. God, we can't raise children in this craziness by ourselves. God, we can't live a life the way we should by ourselves. We need you. And Father, I pray today for some men, some women that will begin today to pray for their kids every day. As they go out into this crazy world, that they will pray that God will help their sons, their daughters to be what they need to be. And they will not quit praying. If they're running, God, they'll pray for them until they come home. Because God, that's what you've called us to be. And I pray when people look at us, God, they will see Daniels. Men of integrity, women of integrity, who are living a life that you've called us to do. Father, I pray during this invitation, this will be a special time for families as men begin to man up. And Lord, if there's women here today who are raising children on their own, they will woman up. And they will pray for their kids and be the leader they need to be. Lord, lead during this invitation, and we will give you the glory and the honor for what you do. Just stand to your feet, and I'm going to ask you, with your heads bowed and your eyes closed, get with your family. If you want to come to the altar, come to the altar. If you want to pray in a circle where you're at, do it. But I want you to man up and pray as a family today before you go. Mamas, if you need to come because the father's not here, you come.
I just wanted to share a couple of things too. With Dusty, you know, when we ask for prayer, like, don't get discouraged if it doesn't happen the first time. Like Dusty, he kept pursuing prayer, you know, like I prayed for him a couple of times. Miss Karen prayed for him, and that's I feel like after she prayed for him, that was kind of when the breakthrough came. So it wasn't just me. And so we're gonna do something a little different this morning, if you guys don't mind, just a few minutes. So I feel like God wants to heal some ears today. So if you have any kind of ear issue or have had like chronic ear or hearing loss, anything like that, can you please raise your hand? Any ear issue? High. Rate it high. High for everyone to see. Stand up. Stand up. Stand up. Stand up. Stand up. Any kind of ear issue. Hearing loss, even if it's minor. Keep standing. Keep standing. Okay. So what I feel like, you know, I've been telling y'all this is not just me, so we're going to put this into practice. So what I'm going to have, if people around them will just come around them and lay hands on them, put your hands on them. So I'm just going to tell you a couple of things, kind of what I've learned, is that when we pray, we command. We don't command Jesus or the Holy Spirit to do it. We just command, like, ear be healed in Jesus' name. We pray in Jesus' name. We command that ear to be. So what I want you to do, the ones that are standing, not just family. I want people other than just family touching them. I don't want it to just be family. Family can, but I want other people in this church to surround them. They're back there, someone back there needs to be. Gabby Grace, stand up. Gabby Grace, Dusty, Billy. Does everyone have someone besides family around them? If not, raise your hand. Okay, so here's the tricky part. I do like for people to test out the area, but I know sometimes they may not be able to know. Like, I know with Gabby, she has a hole in her ear, and so she may not be able to know right away. I know Dusty has had chronic ear infections. He may not know. But I want those of you who have the ear issue, I want you to pay attention. Like, do you hear a pop? Do you hear anything? And sometimes nothing happens. We may not know till we go back to the doctor. But if you hear anything or sense anything during this time, I want you to let us know, okay? So the thing I always talk about too is that when Jesus prayed for someone, you know, there was a blind man, he prayed, and the first time he didn't get completely healed when he prayed, so he prayed again. So we want to pray. And then we'll stop, we'll pray short prayer. We don't need to beg, we're not orphans. We're children of the Most High God. So I'm gonna open us up, and then I want you guys just to command, like, I command this. First of all, right now, I want you to tell the person that has the ear thing, tell those around you what problem it is, okay? Tell them right now. Okay. All right. Okay. So I'm going to invite the Holy Spirit to come, and then we're just going to commit, like, if it's a pain, we command that pain to leave. If it's a hole, we command that. We command that ear to be healed in Jesus, and we do it in Jesus' name. By his stripes, we are healed. Okay? So I want you guys just to pray, like, just short, quick prayers. And, you know, we don't have to worry about it being perfect. Like, that's, there was a man who prayed for another man to be healed of malaria. He got healed, but come to find out he had leprosy and not malaria. So God is bigger than our words. Okay. God, we just love you. You are good beyond imagination, Lord. I thank you for what you're doing. God, you created the body so that we could minister to each other. God, I can't see everything happen. Ms. Karen can't see everything happen. Brother Nathan can't see everything happen. We need each other. We're all super significant. And God, I thank you for what you're doing. We just invite you, Holy Spirit, to come right now with your healing. Just come. Okay, now you guys pray. Command that healing to come. Pray out loud, not quietly, out loud. In Jesus' name, ears be healed. In Jesus' name, we command all pain to leave. In Jesus' name, we command ears to be open. In Jesus' name, we command chronic ear infections to leave in Jesus' name. Complete healing to all ears in Jesus' name. Okay, let's stop for a minute. Okay, did anybody feel any different in this moment? Can you sense anything? Can anybody tell? Test it out, like if somebody needs to whisper in your ear. You feel? Yeah? Okay. Awesome. Okay. You better?
Yeah.
Billy's better. Yay. Thank you, God. Okay. Is there anyone that still feels like they still need a level of breakthrough? Raise your hand. Breakthrough. Or you just don't know. Okay. We're going to pray again. Okay. Okay. If you're healed, if you're confident that you're healed, you're good. We don't want to pray. They tell us you don't want to pray past it. There's no need to pray past it. Okay. Okay. And listen, we'll pray a couple times. And if not, you know, we can come up for more prayer later. That's fine too. But okay. So he just got breakthrough and that I wasn't touching him. You know, you see that? It's not me. It's Holy Spirit. It's God, right? Isn't that cool? Okay. So we're going to pray again. Okay. All right. God, we just thank you, Lord. We bless what you're doing in ears today, God. You are our healer. We love you so much. We just invite you, Holy Spirit, to come with your healing right now and touch ears in Jesus' name. Okay, you guys pray. Brand new eardrums in Jesus' name. Brand new eardrums. Ears be open in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Restore healing in Jesus' name. Healing be restored in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Whatever comes to you, whatever you feel like it, you may feel like a different prayer. You can pray that. Okay. Thank you, God. Okay. All right. Do we have any other... Some people I know may not know until, like I said, until they go back to the doctor. Is there anybody that who would be able to tell, can tell? Awesome. Awesome. Okay. And now here's the other thing. Sometimes it happens overnight. You know, Miss Karen, I prayed for her. It wasn't like instantaneous. It happened overnight. So we just trust the Lord to keep working. And again, if it doesn't happen, we keep praying. We keep pressing in because God, he's a healer and he works differently for different people. So we don't get discouraged. Okay. Okay. So can we just do it one more time? You have hearing loss and he hasn't had a breakthrough yet. Is that true? Yeah. Can you hear? But, I mean, you still need breakthrough?
Yeah, I still got chains in my ears.
Okay.
I'm going to pray with chains in my head.
Okay. We're going to pray for him. Okay. It's your ear? Okay. Is there anybody else that would be able to tell? You still need breakthrough? Okay. Mm-hmm. But yeah, but not there. Oh, so you got a breakthrough? Okay. 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 But you need maybe more breakthrough. And sometimes it happens in stages. So let's pray again, okay? Okay. Well, God, we just bless what you're doing in this room right now. God, you are our healer. You're so good. You're so good. We love you, Jesus. And we just invite you, Holy Spirit, to come with your healing. And we just command ears to be open right now in Jesus' name. Brand new eardrums, brand new ears in Jesus' name. You guys pray. You pray. Command it in Jesus' name. Thank you, God. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Holy Spirit. You're good, God. Okay. Okay. All right. Still there? Okay. If you still have something at the end, come on, I'll pray for you. If you can tell. If you don't know, we'll wait till you go to the doctor. But be sure to tell us, keep us posted, because I believe God is really wanting to work on ears. He said it, so we're going to agree with it, right? Okay. All right. Well, I just want to, I'll let you close.
I'm going to let Brother Pine.
Okay. Yeah.